Welcome everybody. For those of you who are unaware of what ACMARD actually stands for, it's actually the Agricultural Marketing and Development Research and Development Trust. So we're basically a trust that was formed by the government in 1987 from the wind-up of the British, New Zealand and Christmas Island phosphate companies. And so therefore, the money that was returned to New Zealand, a very wise government at that stage chose to put that into a charitable trust for the benefit of ag, hort and forestry industries, all of which who were contributors to the phosphate commissions. So we're very focused on three basic areas of promoting ag, hort and forestry. And one's in the in-market area, where we are trying to encourage agribusiness to look at their markets, particularly from a customer point of view, to actually grow their business overseas. So we provide funding for activities around marketing programs and basically seed funding new developments overseas. The second stream is around ag innovation, where we focus on value chains, and I guess this conference and the contribution to this conference fits in with part of that, and I'll explain that in a second. And the third part is around helping leaders, our future leaders in New Zealand. So we recognise that some of the better CEOs, some of the future leaders need development within New Zealand, and we're quite focused on encouraging that sort of development. So please have a look at our website. As far as our investment in this conference, we're very much a seed funder. So we like to look at new innovations and look at ways and means that we can actually help. And part of that is around, we focus on bringing international speakers into New Zealand. And they provide good background, anything that can add value to how we do things better in New Zealand. So it's really with great pleasure that we do bring Haim to New Zealand. He has a lot to offer. And hopefully it follows on from a tradition from last year where we funded the speaker and he actually ended up being employed in New Zealand. So hopefully someone might attract him here and we can retain that talent in New Zealand. So with that, enjoy the conference. I'm sure you'll get a lot out of it. Dan, thank you.
Thanks, Malcolm, and thanks for all you do for our industry. Haim Lebovich from Israel. I had the pleasure of staying and working with Haim on my Nuffield scholarship, and he's a very disciplined man and a man who is extremely gifted in the area of small ruminants. He's worked for 30 years in the industry and he consults to businesses and governments all around the world. Surprising what he knows. In fact, just recently he's returned from Inner Mongolia where he was assisting in setting up 100,000 goat operation? It's supposed to be 200,000. So they're at 35,000. They've set up for 100,000. They're looking to grow to 200,000. In 2002, Haim spent a year with his family here in New Zealand working towards his PhD. His areas of specialty are nutrition design, breeding, feasibility studies, and economic analysis. When I was in Israel, it was absolutely staggering to go through some of the kibbutz and look at the efficiency of their production. It will just blow your mind on quite a large scale. So without further ado, I'd like to warmly welcome you to New Zealand, Haim, and we're going to really enjoy some of your insights.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Can you hear me? Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to give a talk here. I'm originally coming from a dairy sheep farm. This is a slide I found in the Ministry of Agriculture, the Extension Service. It's my parents' farm. We had an Awasi sheep herd. My first visit in New Zealand, it was in 1982. I told people that I'm coming from a dairy sheep farm and they were sure it was a mistake. Are you sure this little small animal? I said, yes, it's sheep. And it was hard to convince them that it's possible, but here you see things are changing. Traditional semi-intensive sheep growing. You can see it's traditional breeders with minimal management, low input and low output. They are not expecting too much from the animals. It's part of their tradition. And they are just running it and not interrupting too much the animals. Let them do what they know to do. Similar slide from Inner Mongolia, just struggling to find some feed in under the snow. Again, as an example for an extensive sheep husbandry. Okay, traditionally, the sheep, the small ruminant, the sheep and goat, the traditional way, they used to be based on marginal resources. The expectation for low income leads to a small investment on the operation. There was no supplement of food. There was a poor cooperation between the farmers, and there were a minimal institutional activities like research and development or any data analysis on this area. So why to change? Why? What's wrong with it? So first of all, there is an increase in world population. Lots of people are moving from the rural area to the cities. The cost of labor is becoming higher all over the world. The standard of living is getting better and higher. And there is a shortage of water and land. And there are alternatives for the land, for vegetable growing and other issues. And there are also the open borders. Just to give you an idea, in 2050, the population is going to reach 7 billion people, and the part of the urban is going to be much higher when the rural population is going to stay more or less stable at the same level. So it's just to show that this is the trend. What I'm coming to present is a different approach. Increase the level of production, both milk and meat. I'm favoring the approach of precise and intensive farming for having maximal production and income for the farmers. This is a slide of a very intensive herd back to from our place. We have a dairy farm, also some mutton farm, very intensive, kept indoor. They are not going to pasture, fully supplement with the TMR, total mixed ration. Reproduction is controlled. I will say further on a few words about it. And the herd is kept under a computerized management system. All data goes to a computer and all decision made based on data, not on feeling. The main tools. Okay, the main tools for reaching these issues is, first of all, the management issue. It's too weak. Okay, the management issue, lamb rearing and nutrition. I'm going to cover all these three topics. And I put it further down, improving the genetic material. That's in the first stage, you will do much more improvement and movement of production to a higher production with these three means, and just then you can work parallelly on the genetic material, improving it, and you will don't need it at the beginning, this genetic improvement. Just to show you, don't get you too worried about the size, the big size herd that we have. It can be useful also in small herds. This is an example of one of the goat, organic goat farm. They are producing a very sophisticated group of cheese. Still, you can see they have only, at the moment, they have only 70 animals. You see milk is recorded and it's all go to the computer. In this herd, they saved, instead of keeping 140 goats, they keep now only 70 goats and they produce the same amount of milk. So it's not only for the large giant herd, it's also for the small organic and small holders of sheep and goat. So we start with the management issue. Why management system is so essential? We have large herds, big numbers animals. An owner cannot know all his animals, it's impossible. The other thing is the various level of animal production. One of the speakers yesterday said there's such a big variation between the milk constituents, between animal to animal, and it's the same with the milk production. Something like 20 years ago, when we just started to record milk production, I could find the same group of animal just 1 week or 2 weeks after giving birth, animals which are producing 5 liters a day and animals which are producing only 200 grams a day. Having the same nutrition, the same genetic background, and the same husbandry in the farm, but just variation of the production. And we have to find these animals and send them to another place so they are not kept under our condition. We don't have to pay them the accommodation, feed, entertainment, and other issues. So this is the main idea of the right management of a sheep farm, dairy sheep farm. That's why we have to have a computerized system to track the performances and to make the decision. Just to show you some data of our herds from not so long ago, from 2002 up to 2014, you can see the milk production. These are three different farms having the same sort of animal. It's a Asaf sheep, it's a crossbreed between the Awasi that was presented here yesterday by Diane, and the East Frisian sheep from Germany. The crossbreed was made in the mid-50s, 1950s. So these sheep are the same source, more or less, same genetic. You can see just by changes in management, going up from about 300 liters an average per year, up to more than 600 liters a year. This is very intensive, very high energy feed, but you can see that just with changes in management, the production of the milk is going quite high. It's the same with the meat production. Our sheep, the dairy sheep, a big source of the income in the dairy farm is from the meat of the lambs. These sheep are lambing and producing a year between 2.2 to 3 lambs per animal per year, okay? So this is the total kilograms of meat they are marketing. You see it's about 140 kilos per animal. It's including the lambs and the culled animal. We are running a very high replacement rate, something like 40% to 50% of the adult animal are replaced every year. Farmers get very nice price for the for these animals. So from the economic side, it's very profit to do this very wide. So just to show that it's possible. We have very management protocols for lamb rearing. We will have some more details further on. Reproduction, nutrition according to the production statuses, and we have a detailed schedule for each event of each group around the production cycle. So what do we have in the management tools? We have the management system, which is software. We have the milk meters, we have the portable devices, we have the scales, and we have the report that I will show just a little bit to get the idea what you can generate out from this software. So this is the monitoring issue, the milk production. The milk recorders are underneath somewhere here. This, you have this terminal, you can see lots of information about the animals, any statuses, milk production, predicted milk production every day, days from last mating, is she pregnant or not, and some other things. Then, we have the production parameter that we are looking. In our case, we look for the milk production on day 15 to 55. This is the peak of the lactation. This is the period of the peak of the lactation. I compare animals which are primiparous to multiparous. I'm looking for the lamb mortality rate because it's given me an indication for some issues of husbandry, of diseases in the mothers or the newborn. And I will just show you something about the ketosis around the parturition. This is one of the reports. This is the animals in the second lactation. You see, second from 2 to 22. This is the average daily milk production of animals which are on the second lactation and more. You can see in this case it's about 4 liters a day. This is the one of the best seasons for milk production. When in the outer time, the level of production will be about 3 liters a day only, not that high level. But I can have the indication from this report if the nutrition is fine, if the animal are in a good condition. If this number is not satisfying from my point, I'll go out, see the animals. Are they too lean? I'll go see the feed. Is it really the silage is good quality, the hay is good quality, any other parameters from the nutrition? And this is a very good indication for me for the status of the herd. I can understand from this if I'm doing a mistake or the owner is doing a mistake. Sometimes I say something and he understands something else. So we have to, all the time, have to be with hands on him to see that everything is fine according to my understanding, not only to his understanding. This is an example of a ketotic animal. You can see this is the days in lactation. This is the milk level of milk production. You see that within 20 days, she rises up to nearly 4 liters. Then she drops down. Then she rises up again. She drops down again. It means she has the diet is not enough energy. It means that she takes some reserves from the body. She takes some fat from the fat tissue, some energy from the fat tissue. She's producing the milk. Then the reserves of the energy are running out, so she drops down. This is an indication for me to increase the energy in the diet. I have some means for that purpose, and I will overcome this problem, and it will improve the milk production. What we are doing is we are detecting animal falling performances and act to repair. Accurate timing of action, if you have to dry off on day 70 of pregnancy, so do it on this day. Don't wait for another week or two, and don't do it one or two weeks before. Just do it on time. Keep only the productive animals. Don't involve any emotional consideration. Don't say, I like this animal, this I know her mother, I know it before. You can choose one animal for these purposes. The rest are out of this game. Keep young replacement animals. This is very important. Any case, you have to do your own calculation. I'm a freak of Excel files. Everything I run on Excel, I make the decision according to economic benefits, not for any other principles. So you have to just keep lots of animals for replacement. So any animal that is not producing according to your expectation, and I'll soon show you what are the criteria, so you send her to another place to be more enjoying another place. Maintain strict culling policy for ewes and ewe lambs. Age, in our case, we don't keep them off for more than the age of 4 or 5 years, because at that stage, we see there are conception problems. They don't get pregnant easily. Another issue, many times we saw it from the computer. They get pregnant, but they are not finishing the pregnancy, or they finish it, and the lambs are dying just after the birth. It's from our experience, it's data, based on data. So this is the issue of the age. You will have your own experience. You will have to design it according to your experience. Now, PD is pregnancy diagnosis, which is a plus. Animals which have been scanned and found positive for pregnancy, but they are coming empty to the lambing season. They are not giving birth. Lots of reasons for that. The most common is the neosporosis. You know, you have the toxoplasmosis. We don't want to buy. We don't like to spend time for choosing the reason for this. We just send them away, and we keep a young animal to replace. Okay, so we don't, because if you don't doing it so strictly, you'll find yourself with about 10 to 20% of your herd which are not giving birth, and again, having the entertainment and not producing for you. Then we have the somatic cell count. In our case, we are somehow paid for the somatic cell count in the milk. Any other problem? Again, make the decision according to the market condition, and the again nutrition to be adjusted according to the required, as I mentioned before. Just to give you some brief background, we are working with feed center mostly. It's in many cases it's an external service. Some cases it's on farm. They prepare their own TMR. It's a total mixed ration. We have large varieties of feed. I will show you some of them later on. It's a mixed diet. It's including roughages, few sorts of roughages, few sorts of grains, some protein sources, vitamins, minerals, because they are not going to pasture, so they have to be supplemented by these issues. The other thing, which is will be a little bit difficult for you to digest. We have every month, we have a cycle, synchronized cycle of animals. We do it all synchronized with seeders, either artificial insemination or just free mating. We are very much worried about the pregnancies. We need the lambs. We need the animals to be pregnant. So we, in some cases, we use artificial insemination. Some other cases, we don't bother about the genetic material of the rams, so we just keep a big group of rams, and we introduce them, and they do the job very nice. So this is the controlled breeding by the seeder. As I said, we do it every month. You don't have to follow all these ideas, but we do it very often. So we have milk producing all year round, lambs producing all year round. It's good for the cash flow, it's good for the industry, and it's increasing the productivity of the animals. As you can see in this very schematic description, we have the lambing here on, we have the lambing here on day zero. 50 days later on, we put the seeder on. We synchronize the next cycle. Animals are producing 4 liters a day, 4.5 liters a day, and they are getting pregnant. If they are in a good energy balance position, they are getting pregnant. Then, 55 days after the pregnancy, after the mating, we have a pregnancy diagnosis. If she is negative, or she's going back to the next group, or she... And she's a good milking producer, or if it's her second time or third time that she's negative, it's out. Okay? So it's very strict here. First of all, here we decide animals according to the production and to the history of the animal. Is she going to have a seeder for the next cycle, or she's going out? This is the first point of decision. Here we decide if she stays in the herd to the next cycle, or she goes out. Okay, if she has some other problem, or if she's very low in milk production, any other problems she had, so we decide on this place, this point, so she may be culled earlier in this point. Then she is going through the pregnancy diagnosis. If she is negative, again, we have to consider production, history of the animal, which time of which cycle is it? Second one, third one, season that the mating was. If it's out of season, we may be more tolerant, give her another chance. But if she's not in the criteria, so we are very tough on it. So she's leaving. The other way, if she's positive, then we put a sign, a mark in the computer. She's positive, and then in day 86 she will be dry off. She needs this 60 days of dry period in order to rebuild the udder and to be ready for the next lactation. This is a slide of the pregnancy diagnosis, one of our vets who is doing it. It's a very common routine. They do it every farm at least one time during the pregnancy because we want to be, to know, first of all, is she pregnant or not, how many embryos she have, and the stage of the pregnancy, is she is only 30 days or she's 55, 60 days in pregnancy. So it can give us some indication for the drying time because we have to be exactly at day 86 of pregnancy. Okay, now the next point is the lamb rearing. Yesterday there were some discussions of how to raise your lambs. Is it good to keep them with the mothers? Is it better to have them on an artificial unit? This is an example of artificial rearing of lambs. Just to remind us, the traditional way, they used to be with the mothers for about 60, 90 days, 120 days, 6 months, up to the farmers. They used to keep them together with the mothers, and this is the only thing. They would milk only the leftovers of the lambs. They will milk for themselves. And just for the self-consumption, this is a slide from a Bedouin herd in the south, in the desert part of Israel. Now I will bring you a slide from the French sheep industry from the Roquefort area. Over there, they keep the lambs with the mothers until the first month of lactation, 1 month after giving the parturition. What's the problem in this case? In this case, you keep the lambs with the mothers, they produce only the milk that the lambs need to drink for their development. You are not challenging the animal in this way. The animal is producing according to demands. If you are not removing the milk, she will not produce extra milk. So in this way, the first period is the critical period of milk production. The other tissue, the parenchymal tissue in the udder, this is the tissue which is producing and secreting the milk. It's developed during the pregnancy time and the first 2 weeks of lactation. So if you don't challenge the animal in this period of the first weeks of the lactation, then the milk production will be down, will be low. So in this way, you creating animal with low milk production. You can give lambs to drink the milk, but you have to milk them at the same time. You must use a routine of milking and giving lambs some of the residual milk of the animal. So this is the first fall you have if you don't separate your lambs from the mother. You don't milk the mothers from the first day one. So you're starting with the lower level of production. At this stage of the beginning of lactation, if you will milk two times, you can have one milking a day. You have two milkings a day, and you can have three milkings a day. According to our condition, in some stages, we have good price for the milk. We have no quota in some months. So farmers are milking three times a day. And this is the difference is if you start one milking a day, you switch to two milkings a day, it's an increase of 30% of the milk production. 30% you increase your milk production just by going from one milking a day to two milkings a day. If you add another milking for the third time a day, so it's another 15% of milk production. So you have the data, you can choose what is suitable for you, but if you want to have milk, you have to milk. Okay, so I will describe you what we are doing and some problems we have on our system and how we are trying to solve these problems. And it's up to you, how do you want to, what would you take from it or not? Okay, so first thing is we take the newborn right after birth. That's in order to express maximal your milking potential, and we don't want to bother with putting them together. And she said yesterday they are too heavy to catch them and move them. So we found that this is the way to increase the survival rate of the newborn. If you split them from the mother, you keep them on a very clean and very systematic way of growing, you increase the survival, the rate of survival of the lambs. We can do some vaccination, medication. I will describe some heated, clean, disinfected environment that we supply around the lambing and the growth of the lambs. You can see we start with the lambing time. We have some specific area, clean, disinfected, where the ewes are giving birth. As I said before, we straight away take the lambs and put them on artificial rearing. It's not the right way. Some mix of the okay. The order of the slides is not as I planned to do, but okay, I will cope with it. Okay, so they are going to meet. They are just born. They are going to meet the new mates, as you say here. We have the E. coli, we have the Cryptosporidium, we have the Coccidia, and we have the Pneumonia, and of course some other friends that are doing the first day of introduction. First of all, I would like to show you the Cryptosporidium. This is, you can see the wet back of this. It's a very watery diarrhea. Very popular on the very first day of the newborn. It starts on day zero. The peak of the Cryptosporidia comes on day 10. If you are lucky, it's just diarrhea. If you're not so lucky, you are losing something like 20-30% of your lamb, even more some cases. So this is one of the severe problems that we have. This is the Cryptosporidium. Then we have the, this is a slide of the kids that are having both Cryptosporidium and Coccidia. They are the same family. They are from the family of the Emeria. The Cryptosporidium is the first day of the animal. The Coccidia comes up on the day 21, so they have some days of catching up. And this is... this is the coccidia. You can see that it's a black diarrhea. The wool is not shiny. This is also a very, maybe a very big problem. And this is a severe coccidia. You can see these lambs, nothing good will come out of them. They're just surviving and the farmer is spending medicines on them and feed. And we don't like to be in this point. Okay, so what we are doing, we have the lambing side, we have the vaccination, Clostridium, E. coli, we have some, that's good for the colostrum to contain some antibodies against the Clostridium, E. coli, and some others. Colostrum is very important. You must keep a pool of colostrum to be available. It's better you know if it's a good quality colostrum. There's some ways to evaluate the level of the colostrum, the level of the antibodies inside the colostrum. It's very important to give colostrum the first 1 hour after birth, because then the structure of the villi is going to be changed and the absorptions of the antibodies is not so well. Then we have, we keep some of the 24 hours a day around the parturition, and then for the first day, and we have some prevention care. Okay, first of all, we burn the area where the lambing and the lambs, the first days of the lamb to come, we burn this area with fire in order to get rid of all these oocysts of the Cryptosporidium and Coccidia and some other pathogens, so we burn it. We also put some disinfection material on the ground. We do it something like a few weeks before this site is functioning as the place for the lambs to come. This is the site for the newborn to be arriving. It's a cement floor, very clean, burned, dried, and there is a clean, dry bedding. In this case, it's straw. Any other material with the same value, the same function will be okay. So this is how we prepare the area for the newborn to come. You can see this is the compartment of the first day. This is the colostrum area. This is the, they are fed by bottle. Then we keep them here two by two in a box for the first day. It's a cleaned, disinfected box. We change it every day. We keep them here just for the first day, for the colostrum time. Then we found that in order to get rid of all this cryptosporidium, all the other pathogens, we keep them in groups of seven in the summer and 10 in the winter for the seven first day. You can see this is the day of entrance, this is the day of exit. So they spend here 7 days together. It's a very clean site, disinfected, and with some bedding, with fresh bedding every day they're adding. This is the winter time, some heating for the animals, and you see this is the machine with the milk powder. That's one teat for each 10 of them. There are 8 units like this around this machine, and it works perfectly. There's no problem at all. From this stage, they are moving. This is another slide from a Canadian system. Again, they have these units for the first 10 days. You can see the kids are kept in groups here. I saw it in Canada. We saw it also in the Netherlands. And it's very well spread in our farm, this system. Okay, then they are moved to a larger group around this this machine. They're kept here. We'll discuss it later for how long. This is how they looked just a few days before the weaning. Large, nice, white, clean, shiny animals. Low mortality rate. Mortality rate in such a group would be no more than 5-6% of the animal. We faced in the history disasters of 45-42% of mortality rate if you don't follow these hygienic conditions. And I have some reports from other places, they had the same problems. So this is the weaning time. We give them some fresh hay, fresh concentrate pellets to have a smooth switching from milk to solid feed. So summarizing the milking sucking period, we have it only for 35 days. The weaning weight of this animal is about 15 kgs. This is the weaning weight at this point. As I said before, we give them some free access to water and high protein concentrates. It's only not more than 20% protein. This is enough, the pellets. Fresh hay, we switch it every day because it might have to be attractive to the animal to eat. Then you give another vaccination of Clostridium and coccidia treatment according to the situation. We have lots of large varieties of solutions for coccidia. So we run it in this way. Some points of the replacement animals. Stop fattening. Yesterday we saw here a presentation of work done. There's some data from the literature from the Danish researcher called Sergian and Chris Knight from the Scottish Academy. They've been publishing lots of papers describing the damage of fat animal young just around puberty. If you fat the animal around puberty, then you develop fat tissue in the udder. And what I said yesterday, I ran an experiment, a field trial like he presented yesterday, not so detailed with the ultrasound detection of the fat tissue in the udder. But I had two lanes, one nutrition with high energy and high protein. Animal had, let's say, something like 350 grams of daily gain. And the other one, which I designed in order to make them not so fat with a moderate rate growth of 150 grams, there were something like 7 kilos difference when they have been mated or towards mating. Then I followed their production and the first lactation. So the lean animal were producing 24% more milk comparing to the fat animals. But still, it was very difficult to convince the farmers not to make them too fat. But I like them big and nice. I say, okay, this is one story for other issues, but in this case, you have to make a living, so keep them this track. Still, it was difficult to convince him. So this is why we are not fattening the animal. Then we increase, we give them the level, increased level of high quality roughages, high level of crude protein. The concentrate we give is about 16% of crude protein. Moderate growth rate, as I said before, it will reduce the milk production, the fat. What we are doing, we give them a TMR, the lactating TMR, total mix ratio. It's good for, it's simple for the farm operation. We take the same TMR that goes for the lactating animal, we give it to the replacement animal from the age of 3 months. So we wean them, we keep them on concentrates mostly for the another month, and then the months later, the third month, I switch them and add them at the beginning, give them both choices of TMR, which means roughages, good quality of roughages, and the pellets, and very quick I cut off the pellets of the concentrate and keep them on a TMR, lactating TMR, which is also high level of concentrate, but not that high as the concentrate only. The age of 7 to 9 months, we have the first mating. There's no benefit in our condition. If you give them a growth rate of 150 grams a day, there's no benefit to keep them for a later age. I base it on the data of thousands of animals that I've been recording and analyzing, and I found there's no benefit to keep them for a later period. So you can start putting them in the cycle of production in the age of 7.5 months, and I can do some small negotiation about this point, a few weeks here and there, but no more than 8 or 9 months, because it's a waste of time and waste of money. Again, also with these animals, we give them only 2 efforts, no more. We are very strict about it, because I found in some field trails I ran, there's some animals, about 5% of the animals will not get pregnant. You can wait until they are 2 years, 2.5 years, and they will not get pregnant. And if they will get pregnant, they will lose the pregnancy, or they'll have some other problems of fertility. Here you can see this some 6 months Asaf ewe lambs on a TMR only. They are not so fat here, they are a little bit lean. But here they are 9 months of age. You see it completely looks like completely as an adult animal. And this stage are supposed to be pregnant already. Okay, we're coming now to the nutrition issue. We don't have too much time, but we will cover this issue as well. So I will do some talk about the period of switching between the dry period and the early lactation. This is the point of the accurate time of the event. We are trying to avoid fat animal. Fat animal is not good anyway, any case. We need to spare the time. We have to spare the time of 60 days of the other recovery. At the end of the pregnancy, we have to remember about this gradual increase of high quality diet, because the embryos are developing mostly in the last month. And it's also important for the udder to be prepared for the next lactation. This is a schematic description of the nutrition of the animal. You see, you have the parturition here. You have the mating, the effective mating here. It's 65 days or 200 days if you want to have just one lambing a year. So it's the mating is it's about 65 days after the can be 65 days after the day zero. In this period, we give them lactating TMR. I will describe briefly what's inside this lactating TMR. The whole period of lactation, they are having this TMR, like high quality, high energy, high protein TMR. The first period, we give them some extra energy because we want them to get pregnant, so we want them to be in a positive energy balance, not to be in a negative position. It's important for the conception, and it's important for the litter size, for the ovulation. Ovulation rate, if she's in a good body condition score, she will ovulate more over per cycle. So that's why we like them to be in a good body condition. Then we have this dry period. We kept them for a while on a straw. That's because we dry animals which are producing above 3 liters a day, because they are reaching the period of the 60 days before the next lactation. So we have some cases we have to dry animals with 3 liters a day. It's very common. So we give them a few days mainly of straw. We milk them just once a day to release the pressure. And then when they're dry, we put them for something like 3 weeks of a maintenance diet, which is something medium, moderate quality of hay and a little bit of concentrate. And for the last month, we switch them back to the lactating TMR, increasing levels of energy and protein. And the last 2 weeks, we put some extra energy to avoid pregnancy toxemia and to support the development of the udder and have a high milk production. Okay, the dry-off procedure, you will have the option to see it in the slide in the site later on. Very quick, I will describe it. We give them 2 weeks to stop milk production. We cut the concentrate dramatically because this will cause them to stop milk production. We stop the lactating TMR. We feed them mainly straw just to fill them and to give them some fill of full in the system. We switch to once a day milking, and then we just release the pressure because the presence of the milk, there is a protein, I forgot the name of this protein, which its presence is depressing the production of extra milk. So the milk in the udder will avoid of producing extra milk, then it's make the dry off possible. So we complete it on at the day of 86 of the pregnancy. We have a maintenance ration until day 110 of pregnancy. Some cases we have some prophylactic abortion treatment to avoid the issues of chlamydia and Q fever. This is the stage you have to treat it, but I don't want to go into it because it's your own vet decision to do. Here you can see in two groups of animals, this is some mixture of straw with the TMR. This is only the TMR on this side. And this is when they have only straw to be fed. They very small amounts of other concentrate. You can see here, this is the requirement for the dry period. Low level of dry matter, low level of protein. And then you can see the maintenance, a little bit higher level of, instead of 1.3 kilograms a day, 1.5 kilos, instead of 95 grams a day, 140 grams a day. And if you go to the end of the pregnancy, so it's about 2 kilos a day, 2 kilos a day, and 330 grams of protein. And of course, there's an increase in the energy level at this stage of the pregnancy. shearing on day 72 of pregnancy. This is something that came out from Massey University, I don't remember how many years ago. Hugh Blair ran a series of experiments, and he showed that shearing is something that is contributing. So it was difficult for me to convince farmers to shear animals during the winter time. They said 10 degrees is it's too cold for the animals. I told them it's too cold for you, not to the animals. And it's part of the routine, and it's really improved the birth weight of the animals. In our really tough summer, it's improved the milk constituents because the animal is in a better energy balance condition, so she will produce more milk constituents, a little bit more milk in the summertime. If we look at the lactating TMR, we have a diversity of roughages, few sources of protein and grain for energy. As I said before, we have vitamins and minerals. We have feed additives. It's according to each nutritionist to decide what he wants to put in or not. Some yeast, some sodium bicarbonate, some salt. Protected fat is something that recently I introduced for the extra energy in some diets that I'm using. High quality roughages, I put some certain amount of legume, high quality legume. It may be alfalfa, maybe vetch, maybe clover, up to the available materials you have here. Something very important, the whole grain. For sheep, they like very much to consume the concentrate, the grains as a whole. They don't need any broken grain. They don't need any pelleted. They make the best of it when it's a whole grain. They like to eat it as a whole grain, and they produce. This is the requirement for the high lactating animals. 3 kilos a day, more than 500 grams of protein, 8 megacalories per day per animal. That's how it looks like. Have to be just chopped, but not dusty. Have to be to keep the particles on long enough size. And you have anything you can see. These are the corn, the grain of the corn. We have the proteins inside, vitamins, minerals. We have wheat silage, corn silage, alfalfa hay, vetch hay, any other issues. So we are just close to summary. What the main issues? So first of all, the main goal is the economic bottom line. You have to make a living. Collect data continuously, all the time, what animals are producing, losses of newborn, mortality rate later on, mortality rate in the herd. Base your decision on data, not on on feeling, not on any emotional issues. Accurate timing of action. Just to show you, we have some also for the smallholders. This is a computerized unit of 4 milking units on an organic, again, goat farm. You can see he's going to the pasture with his animals. It's good for, as Diane said yesterday, very good for the story, very good for the marketing of the products. And still, he is collecting data. He's basing his decision on data. This guy was in one of the courses I'm giving at the university. It convinced him to switch to a data collection system, and in very short period, something like 2 years, he raised his milk production for about 400 liters per animal, up to 700 and more liters per animal, just from keeping the data and keeping the animal which are a productive one, and getting rid of the non-producing animal. And the last slide is me sitting on a Bedouin tent in the south, in the desert area of the country. These people are nomadic. I'm trying to convince them to do data collection. I offer them as a gift, software for data collection. but they don't trust. They said the authorities will go into it and they'll find all the secrets, so they don't want any computer to go in. Anyway, we are doing, I did a lot of field trail in the, within their farms, showing them some other technologies. And what I'm doing is after we finished the, in this case it was lamb swaying, you see I took the record here, I put it into my computer, you see this is the coffee issue, you see there's some mattresses where they sleep, the family members, and we discuss it all together and I give them the demonstration because they must, it's an essential to show them it's happened in this place and to show them the result on the place. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you will have some more questions during this day, I'll be happy to answer you. And thanks for your attention.
We've got time for a couple of quick questions, if anyone's got any. Can I have a runner?
We use the data recording system from De Laval, which is an Alpro system, and the individual data recording of each animal is fantastic, but it falls down in the software. It's very clunky and very old world. I'd be really keen to see if we're able to get a copy of the software that you use for your data.
I'm not. It's not a commercial place here.
We will pay you for it.
Great. We'll talk about that later. If there's other questions, just put your hand up and I can walk over.
Hi. Thank you. It was a great presentation. I really enjoyed it. I wanted to ask. You recommended shearing at the 72-day mark. I was just wondering, is that contingent on the animals being shedded? I'm just wondering if they're shorn in the middle of winter and they're pasture based and it's wet and raining, aren't we going to get stock losses? And can I just ask one more question, so you can answer them together and I can shut up? You mentioned that you were drying off some ewes. That we're giving you 3 litres a day. I was just wondering, does that then indicate that maybe there isn't a one-size-fits-all and perhaps that you shouldn't have been joined so early if she's giving you 3 litres a day and you're having to dry her off? Isn't it perhaps more economical to allow that ewe to have a longer time spent in the dairy given that she's so productive at the time of drying off?
I'll start with the second question. We are under a quota regime. We are under a quota regime. So some months we are not, we are paid very, very little for the milk. So for economical reasons, it's much more profit to put her into another cycle to have the lambs. For instance, 2014, the income from lambs was between 65 to 67% of the annual income from the lambs, and the milk was just the rest. So for this purpose, because of the issue of the that we are looking for the lambs, so that's why we put her so early back to cycle. It's necessary not the same. It's not necessarily the same condition here. I'm sure here you don't like the. I heard the prices of the lambs here. It's a pain. Comparing to our prices, it's really it's a big pain, and so that's why we are putting them back to cycle so early. About the shedding, you mentioned before the shearing and shedding. I always used to tell them the story about New Zealand that when I've been here in New Zealand. I've been working at the Liggins Institute. It's from the University of Auckland, and we ran a field trail with sheep in Ngāpuhi, and they sheared the sheep and they sent them out to the paddock, and it was really cold outside. It was very cold. So I don't see a problem in this case, especially in our case when they are kept indoors, there's no problem. I have some a colleague of mine who is working in Canada, and they are shearing their sheep over there, but they are housed, they are indoors. Outside, the temperature is minus 20, 25 minus, and they are sheared, and they are kept inside with the lambs, and there's no problem at all in this case.
Well, thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. I have a question about milking procedure. I see a lot of confusion around the world around second letdown. Could you give me your recommendations?
About what?
The second milk letdown, massaging the udder, getting the last drip out of the milk. What's your recommendation?
Just a minute. Okay. Just bring you back to the first one. Okay, here you can see in this slide, this is the you see this bucket? They used to do here, this is the first and second milking. They used to milk the sheep twice with the machine, and then they didn't trust the machine. They used another hand milking, and they used to put it through here, okay? So they used to milk, to use the machine two times, and then to do some hand stripping for the extra milk. They didn't trust the machine. So if you're asking my recommendation, is just put it on when it goes down. You leave it down. There's no more milk running, so you take it down. You don't have too much time wasting on these issues. And I did, in 1985, I did a field trial. I compared two times putting the machine, and just when you see the milk stop running to take it off, and the milk production was the same. Okay, so there's no need for a two times milking, there's no need for hand stripping. Just put it once and that's it.
I'm Adrian Molinar from AgResearch, and I'm interested in your comment about the fat animals and the milk production, because that's quite a controversial area. I'm also doing a bit of ultrasound work on udders as well, so I'd like to talk later. But if you look at the second lactation, what was the effect on the second lactation?
Of the fat animal?
Yes.
Actually, in this work that I've done, I just followed the first lactation only. I don't have any data about the second lactation and on. I cannot say anything about this. I believe that the animals which are starting good will stay good. Animals which are starting poor will stay poor. I didn't record myself this data, but I think it's a lifetime production that will be better for the lean animal comparing to the fat animal.
The problem is that there's an emerging body of thought that the ones that get pregnant earlier, the udder's on the back foot, so to speak. So,
sorry.
The ones that get that are fatter get pregnant earlier, and so the udders aren't quite as well developed, and that's why the production is lower, and that they catch up later on. So it's a bit of discussion in the literature at the moment on that point.
I just can say that what we saw, we put in the same time for cycle, the same age. They've been two separate group, then in some stage they've been joined together, and there have been more or less same levels of conception rate, even though there was a trend, but it was small numbers. There was some trend for better conception rate of the lean animal, but then they run as a whole group, and so there have been same conditions, so but the lean animals produce more.
Hi, Cheryl Ann Newman. at the beginning you suggested that a genetics improvement program was of less importance, but you then stressed how important it was to collect data and to select animals on their production levels, which is actually the beginnings of an effective breeding program. So I think that you're making genetic improvement anyway. And you're losing the potential for using that information to select your replacements, so you can reduce the numbers you have to go into the flock as replacements, and also you're losing potential for selecting the sires. So that I think that putting genetic improvement program down the priority list is actually not is to the detriment.
I just sorry, I can't. I'm not hearing well, so I just have some assistance. Okay. What I was saying is, there's no. I mean, the first big advantage will be before the genetic improvement, just by the management issue. Okay, that's what I meant. It's not that that's your limiting issue is the genetic material that you have here. What I'm saying that you don't have to introduce, you don't have to bother too much, because it's very, it's a big pain to bring animals from outside. That's what I meant. Bringing embryos, bringing semen or other genetic material, it's a big pain, because the regulation, the veterinary regulations are very tough, and I accept it, but it's very tough. So you can do within your own genetic material, and you can not spend time and effort bringing material from outside. You will improve from your own material. That's what I meant by this.
One more question. Chaim, I have one. You've obviously an expert in the intensive farming systems for small ruminants. You've had experience here with our extensive systems. What do you think is going to be the best solution for our industry going forward?
Okay, it will be, sorry about it, but it is, that's how it is. I think you will have to do some a combination between the local condition. It means in some cases you will be able to use a pastoral system, but you will have to add some energy as an external extra supplement. I believe you will have to find a combination of a supplement of energy and using the local pasture and enjoying both both means of nutrition. In our case, because our weather and our pasture condition, there's no way for going out to pasture. We must use the supplement system 100%. In this case, in your case, in some areas, you may choose the option of combining both systems, but you will have to do the supplement of energy and some protein sometimes.